and coming to the game after me.
This thing just turn the juice. This, yeah. Right. I make these desperate attempts to teach history to people because when you were in school, most of you neglected history, thinking what a boring subject and all that. And I want to study science, I want to study commerce, what is history and all that. Anyway, let's go back into history. What was this concept of school in India, particularly? Let's talk about our culture because we are more connected to that. It was the Gurukul system. A child used to be born. The mother used to bring the child up to the level where the child could be independent. You know, toilet trained, is that, every basic things. Where the child could be away from the mother and still survive. Then the parents would take the child to a guru and request the guru that will you take him under your wings. The guru already would have a number of children over there. Guru and his wife would run like a household, which would be a hostel, come school, come everything. And there would be children of different ages. And this child would be left over there. And the child would be taught what we refer to today as life skills. You know, right from discipline, getting up in the morning, you know, elder children fighting with you, so learning how to deal with bullying. Small things like that. And then, of course, they would be taught the scriptures, they would be taught how to protect, defend themselves, they would be taught how to do physical fitness, all around everything. They would be told stories about the traditions and mythology and all these type of things. And at some point when the guru felt that this child now has learned the basic life skills and can be a good human being and a good citizen, he was sent back then to learn vocational training. So if he was a farmer's son, he would learn farming. If he was a carpenter's son, he would learn carpentry, whatever it is. At that stage of time, the vocational training would, you know, come in. And accordingly, what his needs were, they would go ahead. So that went on for a very long time. As you know, the British came in, and when they were a small number and they needed more and more people to run their offices, they could not get lakhs and lakhs of people all the way from Britain. So they wanted the locals to learn English and to be able to run the offices at the subordinate level. So Lord Macaulay was given this brief that go to India and devise an English education system for the natives and teach them sufficiently so that they become good assistants and clerks, but do not teach them so much that they start questioning their British masters. Lord Macaulay did a wonderful job of it. 73 years after the British left, no student questions the teacher. Give instructions, chalk and talk method. Either you have to listen to the teacher or you have to write the notes, you have to go back, read the same notes, put it back again. That has become so ingrained into our system. A child who asks too many questions is supposed to be an impertinent, indisciplined child. He'll be sent to the principal. He's disturbing the class. He's asking questions, that sort of thing. So what we need to understand is that the education system, which was brought in 150 years back and should have started its redemption 70 years back, is still lagging far behind. The other thing about education, which was relevant even let's say 20, 30 years back, was education was meant to impart information, knowledge. So you should know what is happening in the world, how this thing happens, what that happens, and these, or even methods, how to calculate, how to do multiplication, division, all those things, or how to, you know, use the correct language, spellings, sentence formation. All that knowledge, information was being imparted to children till at least 30 years back, before the advent of computers. And once the computers came in, just ask yourself, what is the relevance of a lot of things that we are teaching the children today? I remember all of us who studied in missionary schools, we had a very important book which was literally sacrosanct, almost like the Bible. It was called Wren and Martin. Wren and Martin decided, you know, whether E comes before I or I comes before E, and P-U-T is put, P-U-T is but. If I ask my English teacher, sir, why can't B-U-T be but and P-U-T be put, he will probably give me one put and look me out of the class. Wren and Martin have said it. Hi, good morning. So, they decided and it is followed sentence formation. You have summer holidays and you come back, write an essay on my summer holidays. And every child will be tutored by the parent what to write. I enjoyed myself thoroughly. I went to Goa. I saw the beach. Something, something. No emotion involved. No creativity involved. Write an 800 words. Not 700 and not 900. So it has to be that many words or something of that sort. Why are we doing that even till today? Same thing with calculations. What is the relevance of calculations? You think if a child doesn't learn throughout his schooling system, does not learn addition, subtraction, multiplication, and this and that, is he going to be at any, you know, disadvantage? Everything is now being taken over by machines, computers, robots, artificial intelligence, augmented reality, and Internet of Things, and everything that has come in. But our education system still remains the same. Just to give you an example, when Gandhiji formed his ashram, and a lot of people came to stay in the ashram, they had small children, and they were far away from everywhere else, so they had to have some schooling system. So they formed a school in the ashram. And Gandhiji didn't have money, they were running short of funds. So a lot of benefactors said, we want to donate to the school for the cause of children's education. So somebody gave tables and chairs, somebody gave blackboard, somebody gave something. People gave textbooks. These children need textbooks, no? So they gave textbooks. When Gandhiji saw those textbooks that were donated, he said, take them all and put them away in the staff room. You don't have to give a single textbook to a child. Because if children have to read from the textbooks, what is the value of the teacher? Why do we need a teacher if the child has to keep reading from the book? So let the textbooks go to the staff room. Let the teachers read, study, and come and explain in their own words, in their own methodology, in the way they are going to present themselves, so that the children feel that some learning is taking place. But do we follow that even today? Absolutely no. And the worst thing that has happened to our education system is what was told to me. I was sharing the platform with an American professor who comes every year, you know, for 3 weeks to teach students. And he teaches students of IIM Bangalore, who are the cream of the cream, the best, the most intelligent, the most hardworking, managed to get into IIM, right? So he teaches them for 3 weeks. It was his last day, next day he was flying back and we had a seminar. And I just casually asked him, I said that 9-10 months of the year you teach American students and 1 month you teach Indian students. What do you find the difference between American and Indian students? Without batting an eyelid, he said, Indian students do not ask questions. Whatever I say, before I can end my sentence, they are writing notes. And this is IIM students. We are not talking about some panchayat or government school children. They are so drilled into this concept. After a little while, he said, when I asked him about the education system, he said, I don't know about your education system, but I can tell you in India, you've got the best examination system in the whole world. I hear nothing but exams. The whole world seems to be revolving around exams. Yesterday, children gave comment K. Children, parents are vehemently and vigorously fighting to say, I will not send my child to school. But Comet K yesterday had 80% attendance. Last year it was 82. Only 2% drop in the attendance for Comet K. And Comet K, mind you, is an additional exam. These children have already given CET, they've already given JE. This is only an add-on exam in case they want to go to some of the private colleges under their college quota or whatever it is. But 80% of them compared to 82% last year, which means almost everybody, did attend. Nobody was scared to send their child for it. And this, if you just take a history back, in June we had that last paper of PUC. We had full attendance. First week of July we had SSLC exam. 14-15-year-old children, 97% attendance. All the exams that we have been having, CET took place, JEE took place, is going to take place, all the exams, full attendance. But will you send your child to school? No, I don't want my child to die. That is what spurred me on to talk about today's topic. I am not going to talk. The debate, as you have seen, has been primarily on should we have classroom sessions or should we have online classes. I think it's the most ridiculous thing. It's like saying that I want to commit suicide. Is it better to hang myself or poison myself? At least if I'm committing suicide, I'm killing myself. But here we are killing our children. We are killing the future of our children. We are not physically throttling them and killing them, but we are definitely killing the future of our children the way things have been going on in the last few months. So I thought, I was always a person who used to keep on talking that this education system needs reforms, we need to do something about it and things of that sort. But nobody was listening. Even now, I'm so sad to tell you that 4 or 5 months after this lockdown came in, very few people are even questioning this thing. What is this education system? What does my child need? I am a parent of a child. My child is growing up. My child needs to have learning, education, growth, whatever it is. What is the basic concept of the whole thing? At the most, you know what they are asking when they come to us. Sir, shall I put my child in CBSE board or ICSE board or SSLC board? And before I can start explaining what is the difference in the boards and how the learning is different and all that. No, sir, for JEE, I want my son to go to IIT. He's going into first standard now. I want my son to go to IIT. So to prepare for IIT, don't you think CBSE will be a better board? Not whether CBSE will give a better learning, better education, better upbringing to my child. Whether he can stand a better chance of going to IIT. And all the IITs put together have got about 6,000 or 7,000 worthwhile seats. And tens of lakhs of students prepare for it. I don't know how many finally even appear for it. But preparation like this is done by tens of lakhs of students. That is the funny part of the whole system. And that is why I'm saying that let us not be narrow-minded, at least between us, under closed doors, as individuals, as concerned adults, those of you who are parents or teachers, can we look into the concept of what this education system is and what it should be done. Even if you see the last 20, 30 years, you have seen that initially, you know, we had missionary schools. So the poor children went to the government schools. Those who could afford a little more, even missionary schools, 40, 50 years back, the fees were negligible. I still remember my school had jacked up its annual monthly fees by 2 rupees. And some 25% of my classmates left and went away because their parents said we can't afford 2 rupees more than what we are paying. So that was the only thing we had those missionary schools. Or there were some, you know, trusts and mutts and those type of religious congregations which used to run some schools. But definitely it was not a money-making thing. Nobody made money out of school-level education, and yet we had the best of education available. You can ask your parents and all that, wherever they studied. Do you feel the loss that at that time you didn't have international schools or corporate schools? They will say, no, we had a wonderful, you know, upbringing and all that. And then there was that time as the time went past, you remember those days when parents used to form a queue overnight. Tomorrow morning they are going to give forms for same so and so school. So the previous night you go bag and baggage and you sleep on the footpath waiting to collect that form in the morning. Those type of things came. And then the international schools came. So now you don't have to stand in the queue, but you just have to shell out 10-20 lakhs or whatever they You can send it online also, you don't have to physically come over. And people are willing to do that happily without even realizing. Just to give an example, there was this child who's finished his 10th standard, and parents called me up, and then the child was put on to me, and we were talking, and he said that I want to go to one of these integrated schools. I won't take the name. We have one just very close to my home, and I heard that it's got a very good impact, and a lot of students from there get into MBBS and IIT and all that. So we thought we will do that. What is your suggestion?
What is integrated?
What is integrated means they don't just teach you the subjects to prepare you for your board exam, whether it is PUC or CBSE. They also spend a substantial amount of the time coaching you to appear for the entrance exams. It is part of your curriculum or your daily schedule. You don't have to go outside and take private tuition somewhere. Within the school, of course, the hours get extended. You know, normally a child would spend 5-6 hours in a school. Now they spend 8 hours, 10 hours, 12 hours also. They don't mind. So they are all integrated schools. And this I will tell you from the mouth of the founder, director of one of the topmost coaching centers in Bangalore, or maybe even all India. He told me that, Dr. Ali, we do not even pretend to teach or impart education to children. In the coaching that we do, we are preparing the child how he can crack that entrance exam, how he can get that crucial 1, 2, 3, 4 extra marks so that his rank goes up and he gets admission in his IIT, NIT, MBBS, whatever he is looking for. He said, we are not hypocrites. We are not saying that we are teaching anything. The teaching has to be done by the schools and colleges. Our coaching centers are only meant, these are coaching centers which take away as much as 2, 3, 4 hours a day, sometimes 6 days, 7 days a week. And for what? Just to get those few marks. And parents are paying lakhs of rupees to send children to such places. These are the type of questions or issues which keep coming to my mind as to what we need to do and how we need to decide. So let's talk about the what would be a best school or the best education system or whatever you want to call it. Firstly, every child is unique, you all agree. Even a 2, 3, 4, 5 year old child shows certain characteristics which are going to dictate how the child is going to be in the later years. There's a child who's very social, mixes around with everybody, goes running around, introduces himself, talks to new people. There's a child who's very, very shy, who just does not want to make. He's got only 1, 2, 3 friends, and he's got only the same. He's very nice to his close friends or his relatives or somebody, but he doesn't make new friends. He doesn't pick up languages. There are some kids who pick up languages. They have a neighbor, suddenly come in who speaks Bengali or Gujarati or some new language. And before you know it, this kid has started speaking some words of that language. There'll be another child who will spend 2 years, 3 years with his best friend whose mother tongue is different, but he will not learn a single word out of it. Simple things. This gives you an indicator of what sort of child he is. So what sort of career, what sort of lifestyle would be most suited to him? Accordingly, you can decide which is the type of school which propagates the type of thinking, the type of habits, or the type of things that he has. And the beauty of it is that the choices have expanded so much, and we are still not giving any credence to it. In our good old days, you either had the state board or the senior Cambridge, which also was abolished, and then it came back as ISC and ICSC and all that later. CBSE came in. Then subsequently, IGCSE came in. IB came in. And NIOS came in. So when we talk about boards to prepare a child to come to that level where the child has to appear for the matriculation, 10th standard, whatever it is, clear that and move on to higher education or whatever the life is. So that is a significant milestone or a crossroads of a child's life, and we have to prepare for it. almost 30 years back, NIOS came in. NIOS is a board which offers amazing flexibility, which was never available at that time to any student. You could give one paper at a time. You don't have to appear for six papers in a span of 10 days. You could spread it out over a year or 20 days. You could select subjects. I know of children who in the regular board exam have failed in one subject three times. And the other five subjects, they've got a first class. But they are declared as non-matriculate failures because of that one subject. NIOS said you can select. You don't like languages, don't take. You don't like maths, don't take. You don't like chemistry, don't take. Whatever you don't want, whatever you want. And they gave the wonderful substitutes. They said you can take painting as a subject. You can take data entry, computer operation, and this and that as a subject. They offered very good alternatives. But you know what happened initially? Only people like Spastic Society and those people picked it up. For children who had special needs. So NIOS got labeled as a board which is meant for handicapped children or something of that sort. And nobody wants to put, even till today I get people. Whenever I tell them that because of certain needs of your child, NIOS would be a good option. NIOS, is it recognized? Do they get admission? Do they get jobs? 30 years it has been in existence. It is part of the Government of India, Ministry of Human Resource Development. There is no question of anybody refusing admission or not getting things and all that sort of things. For example, one of our own DCs, two of them, two sisters, you know, who are special educators. They started a school primarily for NIOS and only for the higher classes. So by the time a child comes to 7th, 8th standard, for various reasons, if he's not fitting into or doesn't want to go through the mainstream, they take in such children, small numbers. They started on that. Now they get a lot of sportsmen. Children who are into sports want to spend their early morning playing. They don't want to be in the classroom at 8:30 in the morning. That's a prime time when they can practice their game. So these people decided that for these children, the classes will start at 11 o'clock. Let them enjoy their sports, leisurely finish it off, have a bath, have a breakfast, and come at 11 o'clock. The second level that they did was, there are some subjects that a child is inevitably good in and he studies by himself. A child who is literally oriented, for example, he himself is a voracious reader, English, he can just zoom through. He doesn't have to sit in class going through the portions, no? Third chapter, fourth chapter, fifth chapter. You just tell him, you read it and come and tell me what you have learned in 10 minutes. The teacher can evaluate and say, yes, he has learned the second chapter. So they cut short. They said, only those subjects where you're having difficulty, you can come and attend the classes. Those which you can read on your own, you can review once in a week. You don't have to sit through 40-minute classes of those things. I'm just giving you one example because these are our own people right here and I know them very well. Now, like that, there are innumerable options. Now, these children are not children with special needs. They are not slow learners. They are not dyslexic. They are brilliant students, but their focus is on sports. Sports. How will he make a career in what he thinks he is on Sachin Tendulkar? What will he do with that? We are living in a world which is absolutely I know of people in the sports management sector who are drawing salaries which are in lakhs, not in thousands. Are you even aware that such employment opportunities exist? Yesterday, a dear friend of mine who was in the corporate sector, who lost his job because of whatever the lockdown and all that, and was getting quite, you know, distressed, feeling that in his line of work he may not be able to get a job for a long time. He went to a sports organization and he's got a job. It's 30% less than what he was drawing, but a pretty decent amount. And he's basically a sportsman, so he enjoys. He says, even if this pandemic had not come, I would have loved to quit that job and come over here for 30% less. This is what the reality of life is, but does the education system connect to that? And we'll get a very quick idea right here. Tell us, any of you, what you have studied and what you are doing. Who wants to share? Yeah.
I did BA and then I took up sports. I got a job through sports quota in a bank.
Right.
So I have no connection between history, political science, and
history, political science, and IT.
Economics.
Hmm. Yeah. Who else? Yep.
I did my biotechnology, so I'm using zoology. But then I ended up working in the taxation firms.
Taxing is for love,
isn't it? I resigned, I was not happy.
That's right. Go ahead. Yes,
specialization in MBA and PhD in finance and marketing, and now I'm in doing counseling.
I'm sure you'll check out, you'll get innumerable things. In fact, very often I review, talk about the guys who are supposed to be the brilliant ones who get admission in IIT, okay? IIT Bombay, one of the best. My best mates. Got into IIT, passed out. Metallurgical engineering. If you've not heard of it, don't worry, I have also not heard of it. 30, 40 years after passing out from IIT Bombay and metallurgical engineering, what do you think they would be doing? Let your imagination. Now, here are people who went to the topmost institute and did a very specialized course. You're not even talking about somebody who did BA, BCom, and then decided to move into something else and something. Here is a, and that time BTech was 5 years. 5 rigorous years in IIT Bombay studying metallurgical engineering. Make a guess.
Software engineers.
Thankfully, none of my classmates are software engineers. Maybe we got too deep into something else before the software boom came in, so we escaped.
But what you study today may not be in another 20, 30 years the same, so you have to keep upgrading.
Yes, upgrading is one thing. A typist can upgrade to becoming a computer operator because something new has come in. A banker who is doing manual banking can start doing computer banking or start doing merchant banking instead of just fixed deposits and something. That is upgrading. But a banker going and doing some environmental studies or something else or something. One became a union leader of coal miners. Incidentally, coal also doesn't have anything to do with metallurgy. He became union leader of Dhanbad, is the place where all coal mining is done. He became the topmost union leader of the coal miners. One became managing director of National Film Development Corporation of India. One retired as Director General of Police. One is still heading an international school in Kunur. One runs a very successful venture capital, what do they call it, angel, something they call it. So he runs a very successful company doing that. One became Chief Minister of Goa 3 times and became the Union Defense Minister, Raksha Mantri. He died at a very young age, 2 years back, Manohar Parikar. Very average metallurgy student, went on to becoming the Union Defense Minister. One was the speech writer for Atal Bihari Vajpayee and L.K. Advani. He's still the Rajya Sabha MP, Sukhindra Kulkarni, metallurgical school. One is the proverbial man behind a successful woman. I don't know if you've heard of Tista Setalwar. She fought for the Gujarat riots and these and all that. The man behind Tista is her husband, Javed Anand, metallurgical engineer. And of course, one is standing in front of me. Even today, people don't learn any lesson. I was shocked when I read that IIT Bombay is running online classes. Why do we go to an IIT with all these efforts? See, what textbook IIT prescribes, any other engineering college can. What teacher is there at private engineering college can give 3 times the salary and get him over there. Private colleges have so much money that they can put much better labs than IITs can have, or infrastructure, or hostels, or air conditioning, and all that. It is the ambience. And if people are going to be deprived of the ambience, and if they are going to be sitting at home and doing online classes, why should they be students of IIT? They could be students of any engineering college, any year. This is where I feel that we are missing out on something very, very basic.
It's only a temporary situation.
Yes, temporary. What is the definition of temporary? How long? Would somebody like to make a guess? When do you think the regular schools will start?
Next year. Next year.
Are you confident it will happen next year?
No.
Government has been changing its mind left, right and center. Every 15 days, or sometimes morning the education minister gives a statement, evening the chief minister gives a different statement. So government, of course. But what is your guess? We are concerned about these children. We are not concerned about the government. When do you think children will go back to school?
After the vaccine has come out,
another year, I think. After the vaccine has come out, another year. That's much more realistic. And mind you, people are already talking about 40% online, 60% classes. Now, if the child is going 60% of the time to the school, he doesn't get COVID, is it? Only the balance 40% he gets. So what are we talking about? Forget about the government. What are we talking as parents? Parents are vehemently opposing reopening of schools, but they're sending them for all the exams. In exam they don't get COVID. They go to a strange place with total stranger, unknown people and all. But within a group of 20-30 of his own classmates whose families are known, everything is known, so that if there's the slightest hint of anything, we can take those precautions. They don't want to send them.
But when will the child develop the immunity?
I have no idea. We have one doctor and one budding doctor sitting here. You can ask them at the end of the class. I have no idea. My concern is not of immunity. My concern is not of getting COVID. One of the first people in Bangalore to get COVID was our DCA student. She, her husband and her teenage son. Three of them, they had gone out and they came back to Bangalore and they were one of the first to get it. At that time, you can imagine how horrifying it was. 2 days, she was very miserable. Her throat was in a pathetic condition. She thought she was going to die. 48 hours later, she started recovering. 3 days later, she was perfectly normal. They kept her for another 1 week or whatever number of days and they have been sent back. Today she is coming here to Banjara whenever I invite her. If you wanted, I could have called her today. She would have happily come, stood in front of you and said, "Hey, here is one COVID standing in front of you," and people will move back. We are so scared. Even a recovered COVID, nobody wants to be anywhere near her. So that is the reality. My concern is not COVID. My concern is what we are doing with the children. Children need not just that. Completing of his syllabus by, even let's say technology is so good and children are getting excellent online classes and teachers have been retrained and everything is done. I still will not call that education. Children cannot learn sitting in front of a screen. Children have to enter the school. They have to run. The getting up in the morning and putting on the correct uniform and polishing your shoes, because there will be one PT master who will whack you if your shoes are not polished. That is what education is all about. And despite all that stress that you have to go through, the moment you see your best friend, bestie, as they call it, you are so thrilled, "Hey, dude, how are you?" and all that, and your life is made for that day. And you sit and gossip about the teachers and you give them nice nicknames, and so many interesting things are happening. The creativity that comes up when they give nicknames to their teachers. Where will they sit on online and give nicknames to teachers? This is where we are missing out. So somewhere along the line, okay, I'm also optimistic, I'm hopeful that we will go back to the old normal. I don't understand new normal. It's a new abnormal. We'll go back to old normal. when we go back to this old normal, as adults, as parents, as concerned citizens, as counselors, are we at least going to have a slightly different viewpoint in thinking about what is education for the child and how we need to ensure that whoever the child under our control, it may be our own child, it may be somebody's child, it may be our student, counselee, whatever it is, what can we do to provide a good education to the child? If you look into those factors, are we taking the... I was just telling you that story about this child who got into that, who wanted to get into that integrated school. So I was telling him that, why don't you come over, I will assess you and find out whether you are oriented towards technology or something else, and we will set some long-term goals, and then you decide what subjects to take and which type of school for plus two will be better than this and that. No sir, Monday is the last date for admission. Now Monday was the day on which the SSLC results were to come. I said, results of SSLC are coming at Monday 3 o'clock. And you are saying that is the last date. How can it be? No, sir, they have said CBSE students into the last date. See how they are playing upon the children. How can you have a separate last date for CBSE students and separate last date for SSLC students? For CBSE students, they have said Monday is the last date. And we are talking on the Independence Day. We are talking about Friday, 5 o'clock, we are talking about it. We have the Saturday, Sunday, and Monday he has to pay the fees. Now what can I do? So finally I told him, do one thing. You said it's closed by now. Go to the school. It will be closed. There won't be a student, but there may be some teachers. There may be some responsible person. Go and talk to them, find out, say that, I'm thinking of joining the school. So how is it? Look around, see what the playground, the labs, or this, or that. Whatever it is, get a feel of that ambience and see whether you're going to be comfortable. No, sir, my parents won't allow me to go. They will allow you to take admission and make a commitment for 2 years. They won't allow you to go down 500 meters and visit that school alone without going 2 meters distance from anybody. Finally, I said, okay, tell your parents to go. No, sir, my parents haven't stepped out for the last 5 months. They will not go. Okay. Parents don't want to step out, parents are adults, they want to live their own life. But what about the child? Can we? And they're spending lakhs of rupees. It's not a cheap school, it's a very expensive school, the one he is, must have joined, obviously. They are willing to do all that, citing our concern for our child. We have only one child, we want to give him the best of education. So we don't mind. If so many lakhs have to be spent, we will spend that. Okay, how do we fight out this? I keep getting invited. No, I used to keep getting invited to schools very often. Sometimes I would go. I would make it a point, knowing Bangalore traffic and all that, to reach a little early. So even if I'm stuck in traffic, I will still not overshoot. And if I reach early, I relax there, have a cup of tea with the principal, whatever it is, and then the session starts. So inevitably, when I would go there, the principal or somebody would say, the first time you're coming to our school, yeah, would you like to have a look and show you the campus? Sure, we have enough time. Come. Now, when we step out, I'm walking with the principal, headmistress, whoever the person is. I look at the staff members, either teaching staff or not teaching staff. And I observe them closely. Let's say there's a sweeper. He's sweeping the corridor. And the principal is coming from a distance. He gets the first glimpse of the principal. I catch that expression. If he looks at the principal and he brightens up and he straightens up and says, Namaskara, sir, I know that this is a good principal. If this fellow looks at him, Namaskara, sir. It is leaders who make the team, isn't it? The principal plays such an important role in the school. Would you join a company whose CEO is a nasty character or who's got a bad reputation or something? You never do that. But you send your child without even finding out what sort of reputation or what sort of character the principal has. And there are many schools there. If you find out now, next year you want to put your child there, and if you find out now, By the time you put your child, the principal won't be there. Principal change every year. How can you run a school with the principal changing every year? The leader of the team doesn't want to stick around, or you don't like that him to stick around. These are the ways and means of selecting what school, what system, what are the things. But you ask people, they laugh at me literally. Oh, who has got that? Don't you know, sir, so-and-so school, very big reputation, they are charging 6 lakhs and I got influence, so they said they will give 20% discount and admissions are closing, I have to go there, something of it. So these are the type of things that thing is, you know that we talk about a competitive, but Asha, why don't you come? I think we are all COVID negative, so you can. We know that we are in a competitive world. Well, you want your child to go to some top-notch institution, he has to compete, or that is fine. But would you like your child to compete in anything and everything? A friend of mine, a student of mine, who is a teacher in one of the very liberal and unorthodox schools, and she enjoys teaching because the environment of the school is like that. They encourage children, they teach a lot of life skills, they do all that. She was put on examination duty in another school. So she goes over there, the exam is going on, and you have these two children sitting on the bench. And she saw that every child who is writing, there's another child sitting here, the child is sitting like this, and so that fellow should not be. There are 5,000 other children who are giving the same exam, but I don't want this fellow to gain 2-3 extra marks by copying from What sort of values have we taught such a child? And where did this child learn that from? Obviously, the child was not born with this instinct. The parents have drilled it into the child that it is tough, it is competitive, you have to do this, you have to do that, then only you will be. If a child studies in a school like that, and teachers also do that. I know of teachers who have ripped apart a child because he stood first in the first term and he stood second in the second term. What's going wrong with you? Wasting your time, all the time with friends. You're going and playing. I heard that you joined the basketball team. See, this is what happens if you join the basketball team. This is what happens if you join the basketball team. Instead of first rank, you get second rank. And then there are parents standing outside the examination hall as soon as the child comes out. Tell which are the questions you didn't answer. 2 marks you lost out. Okay, from 100 to 98. Now tell me here, 1 mark lost over. Is this education? Is this what? It's like, you've all seen 3 Idiots. 3 Idiots. When director is questioning this guy, Amir Khan, he says, sir, even a circus lion, if you take a whip and beat it, he goes and jumps on that bench and sits down. But he says, us lion ko well trained kehte hai, well educated nahi kehte hai. So we are getting very well trained. If you want your child to be as well trained as that circus lion, then go ahead. But is that the wrong thing? How can we be so callous to our own children, whom we care for, whom we love, whom we supposedly want to give a good future to? How can we do that? Yeah. I'll just share one incident why I told you things like IIT Bombay, any such reputed institution. It could be Army Engineering College, it could be ISAC, it could be in various denominations. There are excellent institutions everywhere. When I joined, I was comparatively new. None of my friends had got in. I was the only person. No, I didn't have anybody known who was there. I was feeling a little uneasy and this and that. It so happened that a friend's friend who had just completed his PhD joined there as an assistant professor. And that was the year when IIT Bombay started its Industrial Design Center, IDC. A new unit had been put up and he was appointed as assistant professor of ergonomics in the IDC. A youngster, he had just finished his PhD, and he was also from a different city and he had no friends. He was in the staff hostel, I was in one of these rooms. Hostel. We got introduced through this very close common friend and this and that, so we became friends. He was teaching ergonomics, I was studying, supposed to be studying, metallurgical engineering. We had nothing to do with each other. But we used to go for an evening walk, have a cup of tea when I had some money in the pocket, or I would take his hospitality or whatever it is. One day, I asked him a curiosity question. You are a teacher of ergonomics, E-R-G-O-N-O-M-I-C-S, ergonomics. So what is this ergonomics? I asked him. Will somebody tell me? Yeah, you're very close to the answer. But you know how he told me? He said, they were walking and there was a post box little further ahead. You know what's a post box? The red round fellow with that black topi and one snout. Okay. He was a very important person before the internet came in. All our communication used to be through that post box. There was a loose piece of paper lying there. He said, pretend that this is a letter and just go and post it in. I said, boss, this is a scrap paper. He said, doesn't matter, the postman will throw it away, don't worry. Just post it. Okay, I went there. He said, why are you doing this kathakali just to post a letter? I said, what to do? Otherwise, it won't go in. Exactly, he said. Should the post box be designed for your convenience, or should you do all this acrobatics for the convenience of the post box? He said, designing or redesigning non-living things for the convenience of human beings is ergonomics. Wow. Well, tube light was blowing on my head. I said, if 5 years I'm stuck over here learning technology, if I can design, redesign, adapt technology to human beings, I think my purpose has been so. I found my purpose over self-actualization, moksha, whatever you want to call it. Now, will you get that if you are attending online classes or if you're somewhere else? That is what I want to tell you. And it happens at every level. Many of us remember primary school teachers. If I ask some people, who was your favorite teacher? So many write down the name of that Miss Samson, who was my second standard class teacher or something, something they write. And why? Was that Miss Samson BA, MA, MPhil, PhD, MA, BA, whatever it is? No. For all you know, she may have been a matriculate teaching second standard students. But she connected. She inspired. She motivated. She loved me. She gave me that boost in my self-esteem which brought me over here. That's why even now I remember her 10 years, 20 years, 30 years down the line. What are we doing about that concept? Do we go and find out how many teachers there are who have been here for years and years, who have that type of you know, reputation? There's a school here called Stella Maris. Very good. You're wonderful. Congrats. I don't know whether he was there in your day. Balchandar master, mathematics teacher, 10A class teacher. Balchandar master. Okay. It's a school run by nuns. So 95% of the teachers are either nuns or ladies. They hardly have one physical education director or one or two male teachers. Balchandar master was a maths teacher and he was also a class teacher for a girls school run by nuns, that's unheard of. And Balchandar master was a living legend. Girls used to come and talk to him about anything. They could talk to him about boyfriend, they could talk to him about menstruation, they could, anything that they wanted to share, they would go to Balchandar master. So much so, there's a thing called a friendship day. Okay, and kids are very fond of that. So one day before, the 10A children, some 55 of them, went and told, sir, tomorrow when you come, there'll be so many children from the school wanting to tie that friendship band. You tell all the students to tie on the right hand. The left hand is reserved for us, 10A, because it is closer to the heart. And there were 55, friendship bands tied on. And I'm talking, he passed away at a very early age with cancer a few years back. I'm not talking about old timers whom we remember 50 years back or something, you know, there, 5-6 years back he passed away. Now, do we appreciate that? Do we say, I want to put my child in stellar marriage because this is the type of teaching, these are the type of MBA, these are the type of teachers, and this is the environment in which my child will get? No, I will not. So, selection, is it based on that? There was a time, I'm sure Ramasha was there, even the chief minister's daughter used to study in the stellar marriage and all that type of reputation before all this education business started. Today, no better to person sends the child to stellar marriage. The fees is some, now even now I think it's some 2,000-3,000 rupees. And Kannada medium students, it is free if you belong to that, you know, economically weaker section. You don't even have to pay a single rupee. The heart of the city with such good infrastructure, such committed teachers, you can send your child over there. But no, even an auto rickshaw driver will say, I want to send my child to so and so, so and so. That is where we are making a mistake. If we learn this concept, you know, we can really do wonders. Because all said and done, one of the most important things which we have been shouting from the rooftops and not being able to convince people is the fact that children need to learn life skills more than anything else. And that is the thing which is missing. Life skills was propagated by WHO in the year 1990, 30 years have gone past. And I keep on telling people, we always appreciate some Billington, Washington, if they say something. The chief editor of the final report on life skills that was, you know, propounded by, published by WHO is an Indian and a Bangalorean, Dr. R. Srinivas Murthy. I very proudly tell you, he was one of my teachers. He was the dean of NIMHANS over here. Then he went on deputation to WHO. He lived there in Geneva for 2 years. He was the chief editor of that report, which came in 1990, 30 years back. 70 countries have incorporated that as part of their compulsory curriculum. India is not one of them. Dr. Murthy is right here. He is retired and is living in Jaipur. If people want, they can go to him and take his help. He is available. Nobody talks to him. If we are not teaching life skills, what are we teaching children? What's the point in talking about anything at all if we can't teach life skills? If a child goes out to play in the break and a bigger fellow comes and whacks him and takes away the ball, he's too big to fight, he's feeling humiliated because the girls are watching. He starts crying and comes running back and he's sitting there crying. The teacher looks at him and says, don't cry like a girl. What is it? No, miss, but no, I took well. Shit! What does he see here? Keep quiet. Open the book, third chapter. What is there in the third chapter? First battle of Panipat. See which year it took place in. If you don't learn when the first battle of Panipat took place, you cannot be a matriculate. If you don't know how to handle Aditya, that's not my bothering. This is the fact. The bottom line is this, that can we all put our heads together and ensure that children are taught basic life skills, which includes the fact that can we select schools, where there is a chance to select schools, can we select schools which are oriented towards that? Can we have teachers, appreciate those teachers, the very few like Bhaskar the Master who are doing, they don't get any appreciation at all. They have absolutely nothing. Banjara Master lived his whole life in a two-room house in the suburbs far away. One room was occupied by him and his wife, one room was occupied by his daughter. When his daughter got married and went away, the wife was happy that, okay, now we have one more room to ourselves. Before you know it, that room got full of books. And she said, I couldn't use that room, but he had not only filled it up with books, he used to invite all the children in that area to come and use it as a library. Of course. Such people are there all around, left, right, and center. We appreciate. If we are genuinely concerned about the next generation, we have to do something about it. And that is what true education, learning, etc. is. Well, no, let's put our heads together. We will struggle, we'll make mistakes, we'll do a trial and error, but at least we'll create a better world for the next generation. Now, Have you noticed who is sitting over here?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know her?
Yes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
In your institution visits class, we had mentioned about our helping hand volunteers, right? You recollect? So some of you may have even spoken to, say, maybe Elvira or Meera Naik and Jemima, things like that, right? So, you can. And today with us, we have our helping hand volunteer, Mr. Yuvraj Kaluti. Come.
Okay, sure. Come. Let them also see you. There are a lot of people online.
Online?
Live yes. People, okay? Live. Dead people.
So,
Mr. Yuvraj Kadur.
Yeah, he's Mr. Yuvraj Kadur. He's our helping hand volunteers for nearly more than 2 decades. For more than 20 years, Kadur? No? Yes. So, do you just want to share where you are volunteering and few things about yourself?
This has kept me very active. I am now, for the last 6 months, I am feeling so much lonely because we are away from the service now. We are very happy and very active. Now, today I am 83, but I never felt anything like that. But I am feeling very much lonely and depressed like anything. Because no, we are not able to go to hospitals. Actually, we are feeling very happy talking to the people, those who don't know, those who are coming there. And while going, they will say, sir, thank you very much for your help. So that is something enough for us. That way, we are feeling very happy and healthy also. That has kept us away from that service. I wanted to talk to the same thing. What to do now? Even last time, Mrs. Alsa, last 2 years, I'm feeling lonely, but they're at least keeping me happy, engaged in the hospitals. That also for the last 6 months, I'm not going to do that also. So anyway, it's a good service, and it has kept me happy and healthy. I'm very much thankful to Ali.
All of you are thankful to you. He lost his life partner. I'm very much
thankful to Raja.
Yes.
He only introduced me to this helping hand. Actually, I met him in Vasugudi, and we're sitting by the side. Just introduced yourself. Then why did you, sir, come to join you? Then came within 3 days. I got the card. Then where you want? I want Ramayana and Baptist. So that continued. Anyway, thank you.
Very unexpectedly, he lost his life partner of half a century. He completed all the rituals, and the next morning he was back in the hospital. Oh. So I would rather reach out to others than sit at home. Thanks a lot. And we have Dr. Dharanish.
Yes, Dharanish.
Morning, everyone.
Good morning.
How do you want me to share?
How about you?
Hi, all again. My name is Dr. Dharanish Prasad. I've done my MBBS and MD in community medicine. Not many would have heard of this discipline of specialization.
Can we set it
up? Happy to.
2 minutes.
Happy to share that I was a student here studying my DCS, learning, relearning, unlearning a lot of things. And I also done my certificate in life skills here. Community medicine is a specialization wherein the whole concept is you reaching out to a vulnerable group. For example, you have elderly. It doesn't have, as a doctor, you expect a person going to a doctor always, right? But what happens here is you tend to be more with the community. You tend to be more talking about promotive medicine, preventive medicine, social medicine. We have a lot of determinants of health. So we measure with those things to improvise the health of not an individual, but of a group or a community. So we do a lot of research, we come up with a lot of evidences, we make protocols, such sort of things. Just One example is, if I'm a clinician, I'm happy with treating one person for anemia. But as a community medicine guy, what I do is, I want a particular area to be free from anemia. So why did it happen? What should be done to decrease anemia in the whole area? Such are my questions, which I'll be answering in a different, with my different skills and different experience.
Wonderful. That is wonderful.
Thank you, medicine for the community is given by the government or from the order of one?
It happens in different ways. We can collaborate. I could do it myself if I'm competent. I can have a partnership with some NGO, or I can complement the activities of a government. The whole idea being the objective being reached. If you want anemia to come down, the whole idea is to make
it. Is it a group of physicians only, or is it a volunteer?
Here, our motto or our principle is health is a team approach. We don't talk of an individual, and an individual can't make a lot of difference to a community. So we talk of health team. So I would respect a nurse or a counselor or a social worker as much as I do to a clinician. We need this whole group to bring about a difference to our community. Because everyone has their own skills. As a physician, I can't go and do everything. Last name is best done by social workers.
Thank you, Dharnish.
Thank you so much.
So
now I'm logging off. We have our class starting.
Nice to see you.